Can you all hear me okay? Okay. I don't know if it was mentioned from up front, but many of you probably showed up today ready for International Sabbath Celebration. I don't know. Maybe you got the announcement and everything, but just wanted to, for those who didn't and you got here and you're saying, this doesn't look like International Day. So that was actually, you know, through the team that was actually postponed. So we're going to have that, and Elder Sean will let us know when that that will take place. So today we're going to focus in on emotional intelligence. Our title today is Telling Yourself the Truth. Telling yourself the truth. You know, someone else can tell you the truth, but it really only makes a difference when you begin to tell yourself the truth. But we're going to focus on emotional intelligence this whole Sabbath. The sermon today, and because we don't have anything planned through the evening or through the afternoon, we're just going to do a seminar entitled The Lost Art of Thinking. And so we're going to look at the 10 top cognitive distortions or wrong ways of thinking that destroy ourselves, that destroy our relationships with others, and really keeps the Spirit of God from being able to be present and work through His people and unite His people. Okay, so that's later today at 4 o'clock. So that information should be in your bulletin. But why are we talking about emotional intelligence? A couple of reasons. See if we can get this screen working here. Okay. All right. So we want to look at emotional intelligence because, as you see here, emotional intelligence, sometimes we focus on IQ. How many of you have taken an IQ test in grade school? You've done that before? Here in the United States, that's pretty much standard practice, IQ test. IQ, you can't really change that. You have the IQ that you inherited. But your EQ, your emotional intelligence, has a lot to do with our success in life and our enjoyment in life. And you know, the Bible tells us that Jesus came to give us life and life more abundantly. He wants us to live joy-filled lives. He wants us to live successful lives. He wants us to have this abundant life. And that type of living is directly connected to our emotional intelligence. You can have a high IQ and yet not be successful and not enjoy life and not live an abundant life. Okay? So it's connected to our emotional intelligence. I'm going to define what that is in just a minute here. But another reason is that emotional intelligence, as opposed to IQ, can actually change. It can develop. It can be learned, right? And this is the process of sanctification. God works in our lives. The Holy Spirit impresses upon us, and we begin to change. We begin to, in our mind, in our emotions, our hearts, our minds, we begin to become more like God. And so we want to focus on emotional intelligence for that reason. And then finally, very interesting, our Sabbath school discussion this morning was on the Holy Spirit and on resisting and grieving and even quenching the Holy Spirit, blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. What we're looking at today, and even more specifically in the afternoon at 4 o'clock, is directly tied to the Holy Spirit's, I wouldn't say to the Holy Spirit's ability, but to our ability to discern the leading and guiding of the Holy Spirit and to actually respond and obey the Holy Spirit's guidance in our lives. Okay, so that's why we're talking about this. This is why I'm talking about this to you. It's very much biblical, very much Bible-centered. And we're going to see it right in the middle of Christ's ministry as we progress today. Okay, so what is emotional intelligence? It's the ability to recognize our own emotions, okay? But not only that, it's the ability to be able to manage our own emotions. You know, something happens and then we get upset, right? or we get frustrated, then what do? We say something that is harmful. We say something that is hurtful. We say something that is mean or degrading, right? And that, the Bible calls that sin, okay? So it's not only recognizing our emotions, but being able to manage our emotions. It's also recognizing emotions in others, okay? Not interpreting where those emotions are coming from or evaluating those emotions, but simply recognizing them in others, and also managing relationship with others. You know, Christianity is a relational religion. Amen? Isn't it? Yeah, it'd be so, I'd say so easy. In our minds, it'd be a whole lot easier to live the Christian life if you didn't have to interact with anybody else, right? But that's not what God calls us to, right? So it's about managing our relationship with others and motivating ourselves to achieve our goals. So this is kind of the components of emotional intelligence. Now, what is this going to do as we raise our emotional intelligence? It's going to help us to think clearer. Amen? The Bible says God invites us to come now and let us do what?
Reason
together. All right? That's how God interacts with us. But when our thinking is clouding and our thinking is messed up, we're not able to interact with God the way that He wants to interact with us. Okay? So raising our emotional intelligence is going to help us to think clearer. It's going to help us to communicate more effectively. Okay? This is where relationships break down, either in the home or at work or even at church, in communication. It's also going to help us to foster unity in group settings. Could we as a church stand to be more united?
Amen.
Come on, we're not going to move from this until I get some.
Amen.
Could we as a church stand to be more united?
Yes.
Absolutely. Raising our emotional intelligence will help us to reduce polarizing statements. You ever been in that awkward situation where you're speaking in a group and somebody says something that just like splits it right down the middle and there's this awkward silence, right? And the person doesn't even realize what they've just done, okay? Right? We need to raise the emotional intelligence. And then we can do all of this without compromising truth, okay? Unity does not have to come at the cost of truth.
Amen.
We can be united and we can stand firmly on the truth when we allow God to impact not only, you know, us on a theological level, but when we allow God to impact us on this emotional and mental level as well. So, what's the greatest influence? We could talk about a lot of things. There's so many factors, but the greatest influence impacting our emotional intelligence is really our thoughts, our thought patterns, our way of thinking, how we evaluate the events in our lives, right? The way we think about problems that we're facing, and our silent self-talk, in other words, our thoughts, okay? So we want to raise our emotional intelligence, and we have to understand this principle in order to do so. Our emotions are the fruit of our thoughts, okay? Thoughts lead to emotions. We like to think that events create emotions. But I want to suggest to you, and we're going to flesh this out in just a moment, thoughts are what create our emotions. And guess what? We get to control what we think about. Absolutely. Okay. So, you know, the Bible says, Solomon says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Okay. So powerful principle here. Our thoughts produces our emotions. And so if we can tackle the area of our thoughts and we can think clearly, we can think correctly, we can think truthfully, it's going to raise our emotional intelligence and we're going to experience the abundant life that God created for us as individuals, in our families, and collectively as a church family. Okay, so I want to share with you the popular psychology. I just kind of alluded to it a moment ago, but things happen in our lives. We call that A, right? That's our activating event. Maybe, you know, you experienced some childhood trauma. Maybe you went through a divorce or some kind of job loss, or even something simple as somebody cutting you off in traffic or something like that. You've got these events that happen in our lives, and popular psychology would like for us to believe that the event creates the consequence. In this case would be our hurtful emotions, right? So the emotions that are causing us to hurt ourselves and hurt those around us. Okay, so it's from A to C. In other words, like for instance, I was fired today and now I feel worthless. Okay, does being fired make you worthless?
No.
No. But if we think that being fired makes us worthless, then how are we going to feel?
Worthless.
Okay. Another example. Someone cut me off while driving today and now I'm mad. Okay. When we think this way, when we operate this way, when this is our model, we become slaves to our circumstances. I found it so interesting. I was for the Amen Clinic. I was kind of tucked away over here in the back corner, and our job at myself and our team, we had many volunteers come help us. So I praise the Lord for that. But our job was to walk people through lifestyle coaching. And one of the questions on this health quiz, this health evaluation, the very last one was, how are you feeling this past week? And the options were happy, up and down, sad, and depressed. Okay, those were the four options. 90% of the people marked up and down. Why is that? Why would you agree? In your life, you think about the past week, the past month, the past year, would you say my emotional well-being has been up and down? Why is that? Because we have so adopted this practice of allowing our circumstances to dictate our emotions. If things are going well, we feel good, right? If things are going bad, we feel bad, right? Now, can we do anything about the events in life? Maybe some of them are caused by our actions, but the majority of things that are taking place are outside of our control. Okay? So, what happens when we have this type of reasoning, this events in our lives are creating the emotions in our lives, then we become slaves to the events. Okay? It makes a victim mentality. I feel this way and I have a right to feel this way, and I have a right to act this way because I feel this way. And it's all tied to the fact that someone else or something else is happening to me. And we become victims and we excuse the un-Christ-like living that we're doing. What's wrong with this thinking here? Oh, by the way, let me ask you this. Do our emotions have to be controlled by our events? No, right? Notice Philippians chapter 4, verses 11 through 13. It says, "Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be," what's that word?
Content.
Okay? "I know how to be abased and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." So here's Paul speaking. He says, because of my connection with Christ, right? Because of my faith in Christ, because of my relationship with Christ, I am not a slave to the circumstances of my life. Things may be going bad. I may not have any food. Right? I may be abased, but inside I'm still well. As the song says, it is well with my soul. And we want to flesh this out, okay? At the heart of it, it's through Christ we can do all things. Okay? Through Christ, we can be having a bad day, but inside I'm okay, and I'm not going to take my bad day out on the people around me. Okay, so what's the missing component? You all know your ABCs, your alphabet, right? What's wrong with going from A to C? All right, B is missing, okay? B is missing. What is the B? The B stands for our beliefs. In other words, our thoughts about what's happening in our lives. The way we think about our problems. Okay? So, we can't do anything about the events that are happening. Right? We have little control over that. We do. There's an area that we can control. Right? The Bible says that whatever a man sows, that will he also reap. Some of the bad things that are happening are because of our bad choices. Okay? But a lot of things we cannot control. Right? So, the consequences, the hurtful emotions are directly tied to our beliefs. All right, so here's the flow, the model as it should be. Okay, so what we're going to talk about is something called CBT. Now that's the psychological, that's the scientific way, but it is a biblical principle at heart. And we're going to see that in just a moment. We're going to see it from biblical principles. We're going to see it in the life of Christ. But CBT is cognitive behavioral therapy. So the problem is not the events that are happening in our lives that are creating the consequences, but our thoughts about those events that are creating the consequences. And so what do we have to do? We have to go back and we have to tackle our thoughts and our beliefs. Okay. So the first thing, the first step in CBT is analyzing your thoughts. Okay. What am I really thinking? Sometimes we don't, it's like we do it so quick that we feel like there's emotion without thoughts, but the thoughts always precede the emotion. So we got to take time to analyze, what was I thinking during this situation or during this circumstance? The next step is to identify the distortions, the misbeliefs, and the untruths that we're thinking and that we're telling ourselves in our mind. Okay? The next step is then to replace those distortions with what? Biblical truths. And then the final step is to practice telling yourself those truths, right? And that's the hardest part. If you can identify the distortion, right? Once you get past that, that's a big hurdle, but you can identify the distortion. You can know the truth, but we have to live out that truth by continuously telling ourselves that truth.
Amen.
Okay? So, let's see this. CBT in Scripture. Psalm 139, verse 23. The psalmist cried out, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts." That's right. Okay. This is this idea of analyzing our thoughts, analyzing what's going on inside of us. And we can't do that merely on our own. The scientific world says you do it on your own. But we understand from a Christian perspective, from a biblical perspective, that it's the Holy Spirit who enables us to do this analyzing of ourselves. Philippians 4:8. "Finally, brethren, whatever things are true," the verse goes on, "whatever things are noble, whatever things are pure, whatever things are just, if there's anything praiseworthy or lovely, you know, what? Meditate, think upon these things." Right? All through the Scripture, you find it's a powerful concept that really our thoughts are creating our emotions, and our emotions are leading to our actions, and our actions are being repeated, which creates habits, and habits then form our character. So where does it begin? It begins in the thoughts, in the mind. This is why the Bible says that you've got to be careful what you are thinking. And the reality is the majority of people are thinking untrue things constantly. All right, we're going to look at some examples in just a moment. All right, let's continue here. John chapter 8, verse 32, our scripture reading. Jesus says, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. There are people who are enslaved to negative and hurtful emotions and thought patterns because of their thought patterns. Something happened in their life. You know, sad situation, many people abused physically, sexually in childhood, and it creates, you know, when bad things happen in our lives, the enemy is right there. And his number one priority is to whisper in our ears error. And it may not be there like, you know, the Sabbath is really Sunday and state of the dead type of stuff. But errors like you are worthless. You are meaningless. You will be nothing. God doesn't love you. Nobody cares about you. And these are the things, these are the thoughts and the beliefs in us that are tearing us apart. So many people are enslaved, but Jesus says, if you will come to know the truth, that truth will set you free. The truth will set you free. Some of us, we've been in these patterns all of our lives. We've been in the church all of our lives and been in these patterns all of our lives. But I'm saying today that we can be set free. Amen. Finally, Psalm 15, verses 1 and 2. The question is asked, Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle and who may dwell in your hill? In other words, who's going to be saved, right? Who's going to be in God's presence? He who walks uprightly and works righteousness. We would expect those things, right? But notice this last statement. And who speaks the truth where? In his heart. Yeah, brothers and sisters. Speaking the truth with your lips is not enough. Coming up front of the church and saying, I believe this, and I believe this, and I believe this, and I believe this, is not enough. God wants to bring us to the place where we're speaking the truth in our hearts. Okay, so I want us now to look at this principle in the ministry of Jesus. And this is where we're going to wrap up here this morning. So let's go in our Bibles to Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. You know, I don't think I meant to have all that information on the screen at once, but we're okay. Luke 24. And I want to begin in verse 13. Luke 24, verse 13. Say amen when you get there.
Amen.
All right. Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. Now what had just taken place? This is the death of Jesus, right? So it was while they conversed and reasoned that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him. And he said to them, what kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk and are sad? Okay? I want you to notice what's going on here. They're walking. There's a conversation. What is a conversation? You're sharing thoughts, right? And these thoughts are leading to what type of emotion?
Sadness.
Okay? You already see CBT here? Okay? So the event is taking place. There are thoughts about that event, beliefs about that event, which are leading to these emotions. Okay, let's continue reading. Then the one whose name was Cleopas answered and said to him, are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? And have you not known the things which have happened there in these days? And he said to them, what things? So they said to him, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. And how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. Now notice verse 21. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all of this, today is the third day since these things happened. What's going on here? You have this event, and you have thoughts and beliefs about the event that's being shared in this conversation. Sadness, despair. Do you catch that in their language here? Not only despair, but they said, we were hoping. What tense is that? It's past tense. That means they're no longer hoping that Jesus was the or is the Messiah. Okay? So you've got this whole progression, this event, and then the thoughts and beliefs about the event, which led to the emotions, which leading to the consequences of those emotions. And that is they have given up on their belief. They're in despair. They don't know what to do. Their whole lives have just been shattered. But I want you to notice what Jesus does. Let's continue reading here. We're going to jump down to verse 25. Then he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Jesus identified their problem in one sentence. What was it? Misbelief. Okay? Misbelief led to unbelief. And what's their problem? They did not believe what the prophets had spoken. You see, in their mind, in the mind of the Jew, the average Jew during the time of Jesus, the Messiah would come, the Christ would come, and what would he do? He would be a conquering king, right? And he would deliver the Jews from the Romans, and he would set up Jerusalem as the capital of the world, and Judea would be the greatest nation on earth once again. That was the belief about the Savior. That was the thoughts about the Savior, but were they accurate? No, they were wrong. They were wrong. And that's what Jesus points out. He says, you don't believe correctly. You're not believing what the prophets actually say about me. Your thoughts and your beliefs are wrong. Now, notice what happens. Next verse. And beginning at Moses. So first of all, he points out the cognitive distortions, the wrong beliefs, the wrong thoughts. And in beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. He says, your thoughts and your beliefs are wrong, but let me share with you the truth. Powerful. Verse 28. Then they drew near to the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went to stay with them. Now it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, that he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were open, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. Now watch this. Verse 32. And they said to one another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us? So they rose up very early. They rose up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, the Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. And they told about the things that had happened on the road, and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. So you go from the situation of depressed, discouraged, unbelief. Their worlds have been flipped upside down. And Jesus ministers to them. He helps them to analyze, to recognize that their thoughts and their beliefs were wrong. He interjects truth. And that radically changes their lives. Now they're no longer in despair. They're no longer sad. They're no longer discouraged. They're no longer believing. They believe again. They're excited. They have passion. They have a mission in life. They have purpose once more. And they go out and they find the 12 and they share, Jesus is alive. Some of us, we're not living a life of passion. We're not living a life of purpose. We're not living a meaningful life. We're not accomplishing God's will for us because we're stuck in the cycle of negative thinking, negative consequences. So let's look at the whole picture here. This is A through G of cognitive behavioral therapy. Or we could say the ministry of Jesus. So the activating event, Christ died. The belief that needed to be changed. But this was a fulfillment of prophecy, right? No longer is it a this event, a life-shattering event, event that caused despair and unbelief. But no, this is what was supposed to happen. Praise God. Now we can have salvation. Okay? So the belief changed. The consequence, they were sorrowful, yes, but rejoicing. Rejoicing. Okay, emotions are not bad in and of themselves. But when they lead to hurtful actions towards ourselves and those around us, that's when they become bad. Okay? So the D stands for dispute. Okay, their faulty beliefs had to be uprooted. Okay, that was the source of their problem, the source of their discouragement, and all of that. E, their disappointment was really an appointment. Think about that. Okay, they were disappointed, but because they had the wrong beliefs and the wrong thoughts, it led them to discouragement and despair and unbelief. But when they saw it through the lens of truth, when truth touched their heart and changed their way of thinking, they realized this is not a disappointment, but this is an appointment to now tell the world about this great news. See, some of us today, we've been disappointed by a spouse, by a child, by a parent, by a coworker, by work, by life, whatever it is. And we're living in the sorrow of that disappointment. But when we go through this process of telling ourselves the truth, we can realize that that disappointment is actually God's calling on your life.
Amen.
Amen. Future. Notice what happens. They become believers again. Amen?
Amen.
They have boldness now. They are blessed with the Holy Spirit. Amen. And finally, it impacts their goals. Notice their first goal, we got to tell the rest of the disciples, right? But from there, we got to tell all of Jerusalem, and then all of Samaria, and then all of the world. What would happen if we experienced this type of healing in our own lives? How fast would the gospel go to all the world? But it can't go, because our emotional intelligence is so low. We must experience this process of coming to the point where we are telling ourselves the truth.
Amen.
This afternoon at 4 o'clock, we're gonna pick this up, because the problem is we don't recognize the faulty thinking in our own minds. Right? So this afternoon, it's all about 10 ways, and you'll be surprised. You'll be sitting there as I was the first time I heard this. By the way, I didn't come up with all of this. I learned this from Dr. Neil Nedley, who's a Seventh-day Adventist physician who is leading the world in this area, because he's doing it from the Bible.
Amen.
And I remember sitting there the first time, I'm like, wow, I realize what's going on in my life now. And it's powerful when you begin to see that, when you begin to analyze. Because when you analyze, then you can confront, you can dispute, and you can begin to learn the truth, be set free, and tell yourself the truth. And that's the experience I want for all of us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. The Holy Spirit is God's helper for each one of us. And He will help us through this process. But it will take a choice on your part.
Yes.
It will take intentionality on your part.
Yes.
It will take your time and your effort. But as you make those decisions, the Holy Spirit will be there and enable you to go through this process. Amen?
Amen.
And I think that when we do, as we continue to go through this process, we're going to experience life as God created it to be.
Amen.
As much as we can on this side of heaven. Your life will be transformed. Your family will be transformed. This church will be transformed.
Amen.
Amen. So I want to ask you, are you willing today to start the process of telling yourself the truth? Are you willing to make that decision? We spelled it out. Are you willing to start that process? If you're willing, I just ask, would you just kneel where you're at? If you're unable to kneel, stand up. If you're unable to do either, just open up your heart to God and let's talk to Him right now. Let's seek the work that only He can do in our lives. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you so much for the ministry and the model of ministry, the model of healing that you have provided to us through your word, through the ministry of your son, Jesus. Father, so many of us, we are controlled by our emotions and we're living un-Christ-like lives, but we don't have to be. We want to be set free. And we've come to the understanding today that it begins with recognizing and disputing, replacing our wrong thinking with the right thinking that comes from the truth of your word. So help us to do this, Lord. As the psalmist cried out so long ago, search us, O God. Know our hearts, know our minds. See what's there. Reveal to us the thinking that is creating so much turmoil in our lives. Give us the grace to think upon things that are true, things that are noble, things that are pure, things that are just, things that are lovely. Give us the ability to think upon your word. Give us the ability to memorize your word. So as we go through the day, it's right there. We can tap into it. As we look to your truth, as we take in your truth, may it set us free from the life of sin that we are living. Father, teach us, enable us to live a life where we are telling ourselves the truth in our own hearts. Father, you know what's here. We can fool ourselves, we can fool others, but we cannot fool you. It's all open and bare before you. You see us. Let us not pretend anymore to be what we are not. Give us the humility to just recognize we need you. We need transformation. Father, may this process change our lives, change our families, change our church. May your will be done. May this work be completed. And may we go home with you. This is our prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.